Good morning, children. Welcome to the next class of botany. In today's class, we are going to study about another cryptogam, that is the pteridophytes. So already we have studied water cryptogams. They are non-flowering and non-seed producing plants. So here already we have studied under cryptogams two groups of plants we have studied: algae and bryophytes. So already what is the similarity, what we have studied here in the algae and bryophytes, that is algae and bryophytes, they do not have the differentiation in the plant body. They have a thallus like plant body, that is the plant body is not differentiated into root, stem or leaves. Okay, next we have studied, that is in algae and bryophytes, they do not have the vascular tissues. So what are the vascular tissues? The xylem and the phloem, they are the vascular tissues. So these vascular tissues, they are absent in algae and bryophytes. So these are the common things what we studied in the algae and the bryophytes. Now today the next cryptogam what we are going to study is pteridophytes. These pteridophytes, they are said to be seedless vascular cryptogam. So cryptogam already we studied, the plants which do not produce flowers and seeds, they are said to be cryptogams. So pteridophyte is a cryptogam, but it is a seedless plant, it's a cryptogam. But what is the feature found here? It is they have the vascular tissues, that is the xylem and the phloem is present here. So pteridophytes, they are said to be seedless vascular cryptogams. Okay children, so let's move to the lesson. From the previous section, we are aware of the saline features of the amphibious plants. Now which group of plant is said to be amphibious? Yes, it is the bryophytes. Bryophytes, they are said to be amphibious. Amphibious means which can live both on land and water. So as we know, bryophytes, for the completion of the life cycle, they require both land and water. These are the group of plants which started occupying the land, but for the completion of the life cycle, they depend on water. But there is a plant group called pteridophytes, which are considered as first true land plants. Okay, so this, though bryophytes, they started occupying the land, they are the terrestrial plants, but the true land plants, this recognition is given to the pteridophytes. Further, they were the first plants to acquire the vascular tissues, namely xylem and phloem. Hence, they are called as vascular cryptogams. So, in the pteridophytes, we can find the xylem and the phloem is present. So, this group of plants, they are said to be the vascular cryptogams. So, some examples are club moss, horsetails, quillworts, water ferns and tree ferns. They belong to this group. So here, pteridophytes are the vascular cryptogams, and they were abundant in the Devonian period of Paleozoic era, that is about 400 million years ago. So here we can find now some only few species of pteridophytes we can find around us. Okay, so here they were more abundant, the population of these pteridophytes were more during the Devonian period of Paleozoic era, that is about 400 million years ago. These plants are mostly small, herbaceous and grow well in moist, cool and shady places where water is available. So here we will be studying about the general characteristics of the pteridophytes. So first we will see, plant body is sporophyte. Okay, so in the case of the pteridophytes, the plant, the dominant phase is what, the sporophytic phase. So your plant body is sporophyte and it is the dominant phase. It is differentiated into root, stem and leaves. Okay, as we have studied, they are the first true land plants. The plant body is differentiated into root, stem and leaves. Roots are adventitious. Stem shows monopodial or dichotomous branching. Now what do you mean by monopodial? Mono means one, podial means foot. So here the stem is what, it is having one erect structure. The stem is like one erect strand. Okay, so it is not it shows a one complete trunk like structure. You can imagine it is a monopodial or dichotomous branching. So here the tip of this stem, they have the apical meristematic cells are present there. These meristematic cells, they are in a state of division. So here in this some stems, what will happen, this apical meristematic cell, they will cause the division. As a result, the stem will branch into two, that is called as dichotomous branching. So here we have studied the stems, they show monopodial, only one single trunk like structure is present, and they are dichotomous, that is they divide into two. Leaves may be microphyllous or megaphyllous, that is two types of leaves are present there. Small size leaf, they are called as microphyllous, and large size leaf, they are called as megaphyllous. Now stele is protostele, but in some forms siphonostele is present. Now stele is where, what is a stele? It is the central part of the plant part where this vascular tissues are present there. Okay, that region is formed the stelar region. Now here the stelar region, that is the arrangement of this xylem and phloem, is said to be a protostele type. Now what is a protostele type? Here the xylem is surrounded by the phloem. Okay, the xylem, they are surrounded by the phloem. This type of arrangement is called as protostele. But in some forms siphonostele is present there. So siphonostele is what? As we have studied, the xylem surrounded by the phloem, but in siphonostele the pith will be found. Okay, so the pith is present in the center, surrounding that is present the xylem, and surrounding the xylem the phloem is present there. So in most of the species of pteridophytes we can find the protostele type of stelar arrangement. So in the next topic we'll be studying about the types of steles we'll be studying, so you can better understand there. So just you can remember what is protostele. The xylem surrounded by phloem is called as protostele. Okay, so in most of the pteridophytes we can find this protostele type of arrangement. In some species we can find the siphonostele. Siphonostele means in the center pith is present. So pith is surrounded by the xylem and the xylem is surrounded by the phloem. So this we can find in Marsilia. Tracheids are the major water conducting elements, but in Sargassinella vessels are formed. Now here the xylem, as we know, the function of xylem is conduction of water. Now xylem is a complex tissue. It is made up of four type of cells: tracheids, vessels, xylem parenchyma, and xylem fibers. So these are the four type of cells which make this complex tissue xylem. Okay, among these four, the conducting element, the cells which help in the transportation of water, are tracheids and vessels. In case of pteridophytes, tracheids are only found. Okay, the conducting element found in pteridophytes is tracheids. Okay, but in Sargassinella the conducting element vessels are found there. Okay, so as we have already studied, tracheids and vessels are the conducting elements, but out of this, in case of pteridophytes, the tracheids are present. Okay, but only one species of pteridophyte, that is Sargassinella, we can find vessels are present. Next, sporangia. What is a sporangia? It is a spore bearing bag like structure. So sporangia is the spore bearing bag like structures. They are born on a special leaves, and that is called as sporophyll. Okay, so these sporangia, they contain the spores. Okay, and these spores, the sporangia is a bag like structure which contain the spores, and they are present in a special type of leaves, and these leaves, they are called as the sporophylls. These sporophylls, they are organized or arranged in the form of a cone or strobilus. Okay, so this sporangia, they are the, sorry, these sporophylls, they are arranged in the form of a cone, or it is arranged in the form of a strobilus. So example you can find in Sargassinella equisita. They may be homosporous, okay, or they may be heterosporous. So here, as we studied, sporangia contains the spores. So these spores, they may be either homosporous or heterosporous. Now what is this homosporous? Homo means same. Okay, so when they produce only one type of spores, okay, only one type of spores are present in the sporangia, then we'll call it as homosporous. Example for this homosporous is Lycopodium. Heterosporous. Heterosporous, they produce two type of spores. Okay, one will be the large, the other one will be the small. Okay, so two different size of spores are produced, then it is called as heterosporous. This heterosporous is found in Selaginella. Now it is considered that the development or the origin of this heterospory led to the development of seeding plants. Okay, I hope it is clear. So as we have studied, two types of spores are there, homosporous and heterosporous. So the seed development in plant is because of the development of this heterospory nature in the plants. Okay, next, development of sporangia. They may be eusporangiate or it may be leptosporangiate. Okay, sporangia may develop in two ways, either eusporangiate or leptosporangiate. Now what is this eusporangiate? It is a group of initial cells. This sporangia develops from a group of initial cells, then it is called as eusporangiate. Leptosporangiate is what? The development of sporangia, they develop from a single initial cell. Okay, so when the sporangia develop is taking place from a group of initial cells, then it is called as eusporangiate. When it is taking place from a single cell, it is called as leptosporangiate. Now the spore mother cell, it will undergo meiosis and it produce the spores. Already we have studied several times here. The spore mother cells will undergo meiosis division. As a result, four haploid spores are produced here. These spores germinate to produce haploid multicellular green chordate shape independent gametophyte, and that is called the prothallus. Now these spores, they germinate. Okay, as you know, the spores, they are haploid. And they will produce what? Haploid multicellular green. Okay, so here what will happen? This one spore, it will germinate and it will give rise to a multicellular haploid green chordate shape. Chordate means heart shape. Okay, chordate means heart shape independent gametophyte. The spore will germinate and it will give rise to the gametophyte, which is haploid multicellular and chordate shape, and this is called as prothallus. This is called the prothallus. An important thing, children, you have to underline it. What is prothallus? Next, reproduction. So vegetative reproduction is found here, sexual reproduction is found here. So vegetative reproduction is by fragmentation, that is breaking into pieces. Okay, so each individual pieces will develop into a new plant body. Next, resting buds. Resting buds, they are produced during the unstable condition. Okay, they are the buds which have fully developed, but they are waiting for the suitable condition so that they can germinate and develop into a new plant. Next, root tubers, adventitious buds. They help in the vegetative reproduction. Sexual reproduction is oogamous type. Again, oogamous we have studied, that is the fusing gametes, they are dissimilar. So here sex organs, they are namely antheridium and archegonium, are produced in the prothallus. So here we have studied prothallus is the gametophyte. In this gametophyte you can find the male sex organ, that is called the antheridium, and the female sex organ is called as the archegonium. This antheridium, it produces spirally coiled and multiflagellate anthrozoites. So this antheridium, it produces the male gamete. This male gamete is spirally coiled and has numerous flagella, and that is called as anthrozoites. Okay, the male reproductive organ is called as antheridium. Antheridium produces the male gamete, anthrozoites. These anthrozoites, they are spirally coiled and multiflagellate. Next, archegonium, that is the female reproductive organ, is flask shaped with broad venter. So here in this archegonium, it is flask shape and it has what? The base is broad, okay, and that region is called the venter, and that is in the neck region of this broad region, that is narrow, and that is called the neck. The venter possesses egg or ovum, and neck contains neck canal cells. So here you can find in the venter region, that is the lower broad region, it contains the egg or the ovum, and in the neck they contain the neck canal cells. Now water is essential for fertilization. After fertilization, a diploid zygote is formed which undergoes mitotic division to form the embryo. So here fertilization again depends on water. The agent for fertilization is water. Okay, so here after the fertilization, that is the two male gametes, they will fuse, the anthrozoites and the egg, they will fuse and they will produce a diploid zygote. This zygote will undergo mitotic division and it will produce the embryo. Now these pteridophytes, they also shows epogamy and epospory. Epogamy means here, that is the development of a haploid sporophyte from a gametophyte. Okay, that is sometimes from the gametophyte the haploid sporophyte is developed without the fusion of the gametes. Okay, without the fusion of gametes, the gametophyte will give rise to the haploid sporophyte. Then it is called as epogamy. Epospory means what? That is from the sporophyte the diploid gametophyte is developed without meiosis and spore formation. So as we have studied, this gametophyte, sporophyte will undergo, the spores will undergo the meiosis and spore formation will take place and that will give rise to the gametophyte. Here what is happening, the sporophyte, they lead to the development, sporophyte is diploid. So in this case, this gametophyte developed is also diploid. Okay, so this is called as the epospory. So this is found in some pteridophytes. Now Raymer, they have tried to classify the pteridophytes. Okay, they classified the pteridophytes into 5 subdivisions. That is Coelophytopsida, Coelotopsida, Lycopsida, Spinopsida and Pteropsida. There are 19 orders and 48 families in this classification. So Raymer has classified the pteridophytes into 5 subdivision. So among this we can find Coelotopsida. It is now a completely extinct plant. The plants are extinct. Okay, the plant belonging to this group is completely extinct now. Okay, next let's study about the economic importance of pteridophytes. The economic importance of pteridophytes are, first one, they are used as cut flower arrangement. So the leaves, they are used for making bouquet making. Okay, so here Rumra adiantiformis, that is the leather leaf fern, this is used for making cut flower arrangements, for arranging the flowers. Next Marsilia, it is used as a food. Azolla is a fern, aquatic fern, which is used as a biofertilizer. Okay, so for that is the paddy fields, this azolla is grown, which helps in fixing the atmospheric nitrogen. So it is used as a biofertilizer. Next Dryopteris felix mass, it is used in the treatment for tapeworm. Teres vitata, that is removal of heavy metals from the soils, bioremediation. So as we know, that is a presence of heavy metals in the soil, that is a pollution. For removing this heavy metals from the soil, this teres vitata, it acts as a bioremediant. Next is pteridium species, the leaves, they yield green color dye. Next equisetum species, they are stems for scurry. And Coelotum, Lycopodium, Sludgenella, Angiopteris, Marasia, they are all the ornamental plants. So here we have studied about the general characteristics of pteridophytes and its economic importance we have studied. We'll continue with the next